Born in Massachusetts, Stevie Van Zandt is a musician, performer, songwriter, arranger, music producer, music supervisor, TV producer, actor, director, Broadway producer, TV and film composer, live event producer, international DJ, activist, historian, teacher, member of the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, and is recognized internationally as one of the world's foremost authorities on both contemporary and traditional rock and roll. After creating the Jersey Shore sound with the Asbury Jukes, Van Zandt became a founding member of Bruce Springsteen's E Street Band and went on to become a successful solo artist in his own right, recording and performing solo with his band, Little Steven and the Disciples of Soul. In 2017, he released his first new album in over 15 years, entitled Soulfire, which Rolling Stone named one of its best albums of 2017. As a songwriter, Van Zandt's songs have been performed by Jackson Browne, Pearl Jam, Margo Price, Damian Marley, Jimmy Cliff, Southside Johnny and the Asbury Jukes, Gary U.S. Bonds, Darlene Love, Nancy Sinatra, Brian Setzer, Black Uhura, and many more. As a music producer, Van Zandt co-produced the seminal Bruce Springsteen and the E Street Band albums The River and Born in the USA. He recently arranged and produced Introducing Darlene Love, the critically acclaimed new album. As an actor, Van Zandt co-starred in all 7 seasons of The Sopranos, the single most critically acclaimed TV drama in history, playing principal character Silvio Dante, a character that he created. Van Zandt also starred in, co-wrote, executive produced, provided music supervision and scoring, and directed the final episode for the award-winning series Lilyhammer. In April of 2002, Van Zandt launched his Renegade Nation's flagship brand, Little Steven's Underground Garage, an internationally syndicated terrestrial radio show. Each week, he takes audiences on a 2-hour trip of what was cool in all 6 decades of rock and roll, and also features the best emerging bands worldwide. The show has aired over 750 consecutive weekly episodes and has introduced over 700 new bands. It is broadcast on over 130 stations in more than 200 markets, including internationally in Canada, London, Italy, Spain, Ireland, Sweden, Belgium, Peru, and Australia, as well as worldwide on the American Forces Network and Voice of America. Quote unquote, it's the best rock and roll show in the world, period, says Billy Joel Armstrong of Green Day. In 2004, Sirius Satellite Radio recruited Van Zandt to create its first original content. He would start the service's first 24/7 channel while continuing to record his syndicated terrestrial show. As an activist, Van Zandt formed Artists United Against Apartheid in 1985 and wrote Sun City, an anthemic rock, hip-hop, R&B song protesting the apartheid system symbolized by the South African resort, Sun City. Over 50 artists, including Gil Scott-Heron, Ringo Starr, Bob Dylan, Bono, Keith Richards, Run-DMC, and Miles Davis performed on the track, which spawned a consciousness-raising album of the same name. It was described by rock critic Dave Marsh as the most diverse lineup of popular musicians ever assembled for a single session. As one of the first collaborators among major recording stars to support a political rather than a social cause, it is considered to be a fatal blow to apartheid, leading to Nelson Mandela being freed only a few years later. What brings Van Zandt to our master session today is a branch of his incredible activism called the Rock and Roll Forever Foundation. The Rock and Roll Forever Foundation was founded to provide a simultaneous solution to 2 escalating problems: music classes being cut and a high school dropout epidemic. Van Zandt's Rock and Roll Forever Foundation has launched TeachRock.org. TeachRock is an online educational resource and is offered free of charge to educators and individuals everywhere. Interdisciplinary in nature, TeachRock is geared toward middle and high school, but includes resources for learning at all levels. Launched in the fall of 2013, the website offers new lesson plans and teaching resources on a regular basis. The Songwriters Hall of Fame and Stuyvesant High School are incredibly proud to bring Stevie Van Zandt into today's Songwriters Hall of Fame Master Session at Stuyvesant High School. Let's welcome Stevie. Welcome, Stevie.
Hello.
How are you today?
Okay, I'm exhausted after that intro.
Well, that's quite a set of accomplishments, and you have so much to be proud of. And we are, on behalf of the Songwriters Hall of Fame and Stuyvesant High School, we are extremely proud to have you with us today. Thank you for taking some time out of your busy schedule and, under the current circumstances where everybody is, more stressed than I think we would like to be. So thank you for doing this with us. I think this means a lot to the kids, and this is a terrific thing.
My pleasure.
So, I would love to start off with just a couple questions for you. And then we're going to be, for those of you listening out there, we're going to be heading into a student song workshop shortly. We have the students online, which is terrific. So we're going to get to that in a few minutes. But first, I wanted to ask you, let's start off with the Jersey sound for a minute, because really that's something that you helped to create. Can you talk a little bit about like what musical genres go into the Jersey sound? What is that all about?
Well, we kind of stumbled into something that we didn't really realize at the time, but up until Southside Johnny and the Asbury Jukes, bar bands were required to play what they called the top 40, which was the top 40 pop hits on the radio.
Right.
And we happened to find a bar that was about to close. So we made a deal with them, that we would just play for the door and they could take the bar, but we were going to play anything we wanted. And so we kind of broke precedent and really were the first ones to ever do that. We decided to do a mixture of rock and roll, guitar-oriented rock and roll, with horns, with R&B and soul horns. So it became a combination of rock and soul, a hybrid. And that kind of changed the entire bar band scene, After that, people were expected to kind of do a similar kind of rock and soul thing. And that became synonymous with what bar bands were doing. So it's a mixture of tradition, I'd say, is a big part of it. We have a respect for tradition, and you can hear the tradition in our music. And that carries through right through to today. It's always new because it's new material and an audience is always new. So we were able to, sort of keep the tradition going and continue to expand it and expand the audience for it. It's kind of timeless because it hasn't been trendy since the 60s, really. So,
right.
We're not in doing anything that's really fashionable or trendy, which kind of makes it timeless in a way and gives it some depth and helps give it longevity.
Excellent. I'm curious, one of the things that I heard you talk about in some of your prior, interviews is how you see that music has been, removed a couple generations now, obviously from the blues, and to, what it evolved into through rock and roll and technology and America, the American influence on all of that. For you, I heard you say that like there was a real life and death kind of urgency to creating, rock and roll. Do you think that urgency is missing now in music? And do you think that perhaps because of what we're going through in the current moment, that might return to pop music?
Well, the infrastructure for rock and roll is almost all gone. Which is what I've been trying to rebuild for the last 20 years. It's why I did my radio show. It's why we started the show on Sirius Satellite. That's why we started the rock history curriculum. Pretty much, my record label is dedicated to mostly that kind of new rock and roll music. Everything we're doing you know, is trying to rebuild the infrastructure to give what we know as the art form of rock the ability to be accessible. You know, we have to be able to, generation to generation, we have to make this stuff accessible for the new generations to discover it and be motivated by it and inspired by it. There's something about our particular art form that communicates substance. And I think some of that is missing these days from the general, you know, we're no longer in a rock era. I clocked the rock era from 65 to 95, from Bob Dylan's Like a Rolling Stone to Kurt Cobain's death. Pretty much at that point, we went back to being a pop era. And pop music, you know, is wonderful. I'm not putting it down in any kind of way, but it's not known for carrying substance. Where rock music, it was a prerequisite for rock music, you know, generally. I mean, you know, there's all kinds of rock music, but basically the essential sort of central definition of rock music was expected to carry substance, you know? So I want to, it's important, I think, that we, you know, put the phone lines back up or connect the internet, however, whatever analogy or metaphor you want to use. We need to reconnect the ability for rock music to exist so that communication between us can continue, not only in our own country, but worldwide. You know, it was the greatest way of communicating worldwide that I think the world has ever discovered. I mean, you know, music in general, art in general is great for that. But rock and roll particularly had something that translated worldwide and was able to communicate its very important content and substance having to do with our lives and what we have in common and focusing on what we have in common, which we need very much right now. And for some reason, some of the other music forms, you know, while they're just, they could be entertaining, they can be a lot of fun, but they don't seem to carry that same element of substance that was a requirement for rock, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I agree with you. I think rock is an incredible vehicle for communication. And, you know, before we move into the student song workshop, because I think we're about ready to go there, I would like to, you know, thank you for just putting together the incredible Teach Rock curriculum and the team that you've assembled. It's really, you know, as a teacher, as a music teacher, I have to say that it's really first rate in terms of what you've put together. You know, the kids really, it resonates with the kids. You know, there's an element of something very alive in what you guys have put together. So, you know, thank you for Teach Rock. It's really, it's a gift to the world. It really is. And for any teachers out there that are, you know, tuned in, if you haven't checked out teachrock.org, you know, do yourselves a favor and check it out. So, you know, what we're here for today is the students, right? So we have three great songs that were written by Stuyvesant High School students from New York City. Let's hear it for New York. In the five boroughs. And we're going to start with Zoe Buff's song, Betrayed.
So real to have a true friend. Hey,
Very good. Very good. Okay. So Zoe, I always like to encourage people to when they're writing something to know their purpose, you know, before they do it. What did you intend for this song to accomplish exactly? What was your intention?
Well, someone who put too much faith and trust in someone else, like a really, really important friend, and that friend didn't turn out to be the person that they thought that they were. And I mean, this song is a lot more dramatic than what I've went through, but I've had friends who weren't who I thought they were. So that was my motivation for writing this song.
And let me ask you, just musically, you seem to be a little bit into Broadway. Am I right? Are you into like Broadway music?
Yeah. I like musicals a lot.
Yeah. Yeah. I could sense that. It seemed like, it was a great song, like part of a Broadway show. So the only thing I would suggest is it's sometimes, this is what we call a revenge type song, you know, it's the purpose of which is sort of, revenge oriented, I would suggest, giving a thought to actually rewriting it in a way, because what this does is kind of makes you, the singer, kind of a victim, you know?
I see.
And so, regain your mojo, your own sort of dignity, try rewriting it as if you're talking to that person that betrayed you. Let me just suggest listening to the greatest revenge songs ever, which is Bob Dylan's Positively 4th Street. He also, like a Rolling Stone, also those two singles that he had, 1965, they're both revenge songs, you know? And he's talking to the person. Give those songs a listen and then try and kind of rewrite it in a way where you're talking to him, you know? It puts you back on top in a way, you know, rather than being the victim, you know, of the betrayal. You know, we have the most autobiographical art form in the world, so most of the time people think that we are actually talking about ourselves when the writer is also the singer, you know, but that's not necessarily true, of course, you know, it just appears that way, you know, but I think in this case, I think, you know, you just try turning it around a little bit and talk to him, you know, and see where that goes. Just as an experiment, as a kind of an exercise, you know?
Okay.
Yeah, it'll be fun. All right.
That's excellent feedback. Yeah, take your power back, Zoe. Take your power back. Exactly. All right, next up we have Justin Shaw's Jonestown Double Cup.
Keep singing to me, trying to know.
All right. Great. That's intense. I tell you, that's really, really good. Did you do all that yourself, Justin?
Yeah.
Wow.
Like everything, yeah.
You got a really good sense of, again, this just feels like part of a bigger thing to me, you know? The last one was like a Broadway show. This is not a Broadway show. This is this feels like a movie to me, you know? It's like a really dark, you know, I call this category dark cinema, you know? It's really, really, really good. You know, what was your, what did you have in mind? You know, what is this about in your mind?
Like the song, like overall?
Yeah.
Well, it was kind of like, it's kind of about just like the drug culture that exists and just like, you know, how people can get pulled into that. So it's got like kind of cult imagery too, and it's kind of drawing a parallel with that.
Right. 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 So it's like the, a double shot of Kool-Aid? Is that what the title kind of, you know? yeah. What the only metaphor I don't get is what do you mean by white bars? I didn't get the white bars.
Xanax.
What is it?
Like Xanax, because it can be really addictive, like an anxiety medication.
Oh, and they're known as white bars.
Yeah.
The Xanax. Oh. Yeah. See, learn something new every day. But this is really exceptional, Justin. I got to tell you the truth. I mean, this is great imagery. You know, I thought it's probably about drugs, but it also could be like in a vampire movie. You know.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It feels like a vampires talking to each other, you know? Maybe they're vampire junkies, you know? How about that? Like a double horror movie. Anyway, I would suggest you go into, like, you know, scoring movies, man. I mean, really, think about it, because this thing's a movie, you know? You got a good feel for it, and you know, it's just the sounds. You know, the sounds are quite interesting and unique, and you know, you really very specifically, it's a really complimentary sound effects. You know, with the lyrics, it's really, 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 really well done, man. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Excellent job. Yeah, and very, very cinematic. So congratulations for that track and song. Next up, we have Leah D'Silva, who will be performing Who I Am Meant to Be.
I won't believe in fairy tales, cause I'll never get that story. Every year is just like the last, but still don't know where I'm going. Keep looking for the answers, I keep coming up with blanks. I knew what to do and what the future
So tell me first, you know, what are you thinking when you wrote the song?
Like that week that I wrote it, I was talking a lot with my friends about like where we're going to go to college, what we're going to do with our lives afterwards. And I realized that I don't know at all. And I was
welcome to the club.
And I was like thinking like how everyone else has their life planned out and I don't know what I'm going to do like I did when I was younger, but as I grew up, I didn't as much anymore, I guess. Like I had different interests and I never really figured out my one path, and then that was what I wrote about.
Well, just, you know, real quick, since we don't have a lot of time, I think what might be fun and interesting, well, first of all, musically, the B section, while it is a beautiful melody, and it could be a verse of another song. Actually, it's nice, but musically, the B section, what I call the B section, the pre-chorus, needs a little work musically. You know, it's not quite. It's got to be a bridge from the verse to the chorus that builds into it somehow, and it's a little too similar, you know. You just got to think about that a little bit in terms of just musically. I think that it could be a little bit more helpful. But lyrically, I think just for a fun exercise, you know, instead of, you know, sometimes it's fun to kind of disguise what you're saying. You know, obviously, you know, this is very much autobiographical, but sometimes it's kind of more interesting to disguise it and try rewriting it as you giving advice to somebody else. You know, maybe it's a friend or a mother talking to their daughter, and then, you know, you talk about maybe in the chorus how you're there for them. You know, you're there, you know, regardless of how confusing the world is, you know, they can always have the strength knowing that you're there to support them. But I think, you know, the whole thing will be more emotional if it's you talking to somebody else, you know, rather than me, you know. Let's make it about them, you know. Have some fun with that and try, you know, say a lot of the same things. I think there's a little bit, probably too many words. You know, you're gonna try and reduce some of the. These are what I would call good reference lyrics, because reference lyrics are just saying exactly what you want to say. You know, and that's always a good place to start. I tell everybody when they're starting to write a song, don't stare at that blank piece of paper. That's the worst thing that can happen to you. Decide what you want to write about and just write it. Write it plain out exactly like this, you know, this is exactly what you want to say. And then you go back to it and say, okay, now how can I make it a little bit more poetic, maybe a little bit more disguised, a little bit more metaphorical, maybe, you know what I mean? Put some symbolism, you know, you want to add the poetry, you know, later rather than laboring over every single word at first and just, and you end up staring at a blank piece of paper for weeks, you know. Get it all down. It doesn't have to be poetic. It doesn't have to even make sense, you know. Just get down exactly what you want to say, you know. And then you revisit it and they say, okay, now let's refine it and make it a better song. See what you can do with it, you know?
Yeah, I think that's great advice. Thank you for so much for you know, offering that critique to the students. I think it's invaluable. You know, and very different things that you had to say to each of them, which is excellent.
Yeah, talented students.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah, they are. Stuyvesant's got some incredible students, and New York City at large, you know, we're a 1.1 million kids strong school system. So there's lots of talent in that school system.
Wow.
Yeah. So next up, I have a, you know, I always like to tell kids that musical instruments themselves are actually pieces of technology. You know, like the Baroque organ from Bach's era was the most sophisticated piece of equipment on the planet at that point in time. And to that end, you know, the thing that's on the horizon for us now is artificial intelligence. So I've taken, hopefully you don't mind, I've taken your Sun City chorus and I've fed that into Watson Beat, which is an artificial intelligence music production system. So we could take a listen to the Sun City Variations by IBM Watson Beat. It is video number 5.
IBM Watson Beat started life as a hobby project for Janani Mukundan, who has a PhD in computer engineering from Cornell University and was a member of the IBM research team in Austin, Texas. Mukundan was intrigued about the potential for IBM Watson artificial intelligence technology to be computationally creative and recognized that music could be the ideal domain. She comments, "Music combines mathematical rules and structures with human creativity, so I felt it would be a great starting point for an experiment in machine learning. I set out to build a neural network that would ultimately compose original music. We fed a huge number of data points into the neural network and linked them with information on both emotions and musical genres. To use Watson Beat, you simply provide up to 10 seconds of MIDI music, maybe by plugging in a keyboard and playing a basic melody or set of chords, and tell the system what kind of mood you want the output to sound like. The neural network understands music theory and how emotions are connected to different musical elements, and then it takes your basic ideas and creates something completely new. For today's master session, I have taken the chorus melody from Stevie Van Zandt's Sun City and played it into the Watson Beat AI. I asked Watson Beat to create original compositions based on Van Zandt's melody in various musical genres, including anthematic, EDM, inspirational, pop funk, and reggae pop. Here are some of my favorite musical moments which Watson Beat generated. For the final piece, I chose the reggae pop genre. Watson Beat's composition runs a little over 1 minute in length. The AI composed all of the contrasting musical sections, designated as section 0 to section 3, which I made easier to see by labeling them with contrasting colors. I did help the AI by choosing aesthetically pleasing sounds and adding some transitions, but otherwise, this is what Watson Beat actually created. Thank you.
So there's Watson Beats' take on, the chorus of Sun City. And so my question to you, you know, I kind of have fun with this. And I just, the question is, you know, who do you think owns a piece of music that's been created by an AI that's based on, you know, genres and art that human beings created?
Who owns it?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if from what I just heard, it's really completely unrecognizable. You know, you would never really know it came from that song. Yeah, you know, I think. Whoever owns a computer, I guess, you know, owns it, right? You know, I don't know. I mean, you know, I got a pretty much artificial intelligence myself. You know, I don't really know. You know, in that case, it's literally probably the owner of the computer would own it. I wouldn't mention where the stuff came from if I were you. You know, but I would keep that to myself. You know. Or else, you know, you can end up with what Pharrell just went through with the Marvin Gaye estate. You know, it probably could make some very fine elevator music or something, you know. Or DJ rave music, for that matter. It's almost the same thing, just a heavier beat, right?
Yeah. Well, thank you for, you know, for taking a listen. And
fine. Nice.
Next, I want to transition. We have... you know, as you've already been able to tell, we have some incredibly talented students at Stuyvesant. We have a little tribute that the kids put together for you. And it starts off with my former high school band director, Dan Giordano, introduces. So let's go ahead and play that.
Hi, my name is Dan Giordano, and I'm the superintendent of schools of the Lindenhurst Public Schools. I was Harold Stephan's high school band director, and it's always inspiring for me to see the next generation of music makers. Let's have a nice virtual round of applause for Stuyvesant students Kai Mendelbaum, Julian Cunningham, and Max Maher and friends, who will be performing cover songs produced and written by Stevie Van Zandt. Enjoy.
Be with my family. understand me have got nowhere else to go. And the river opens for the righteous. And the river opens for the righteous. And the river opens for the righteous someday. And I was talking with my sister. She looked so fine. I said, baby, what's on your mind? She said, I want to run like a lion, released from the cages, released from the rages burning in my heart tonight.
Just wrap your
So, you know, a big thank you again from the Stuyvesant community and the students of Stuyvesant who proudly put that together for you.
Oh, very nice. Very nice.
Great job, guys. I know that we're running a little bit over. Do you have a couple more minutes or?
Yeah, I got time.
All right. Excellent. So, you know, we reached out, thanks to your lovely staff and Christine, reached out to some students from Stuyvesant and asked, you know, what they would like to ask you. The number one question, or what I'd like to start with first is, what is your proudest accomplishment? This comes from Lillian.
Well, I guess it would have to be, getting Nelson Mandela out of jail and overthrowing the South African government. You don't get one of those every day. So, you know, that's one of the proudest moments of my life, seeing him come out of jail. Because in spite of the fact that we were completely successful with the boycott and overcoming Reagan's veto of the legislation, you know, one hurdle after the other, you know, we kept winning and winning and winning. In spite of all that, it was still quite a moment, you know, when he came walking out of jail, I must say. So it's probably that. I'm also very proud of our TeachRock music history curriculum. I think that will live beyond me. And I'm also proud of my radio format, which both of them, both radio formats, which again, I think will live beyond me. Very important that we make sure that the renaissance of the 50s and 60s is available and accessible to future generations, you know. Renaissances don't come along very often, every couple of hundred years. And I think the 60s will be studied for hundreds of years to come. I believe that strongly about it. So I think, you know, I'm proud of those things, I guess, the most.
Yeah, you know, I was speaking with a friend earlier in the week, and she said, Stevie Van Zandt, he's a true Renaissance man. And really, you are truly a Renaissance man, you know, to the core. Question number two, actually related to the first question, as an activist, when you put together the Sun City piece of music, you involved so many people, right? So this is a question from Sequoia. In his words, how are you able to effectively organize so many people in projects such as Sun City? And what is the process of collaborating with other musicians?
Well, I must say, our project was completely unorganized. the guys who organized their projects were, you know, Bob Geldof, and Quincy Jones, on their two things. You know, they had it very organized. They had the people come in all at once, and they had everyone had their line to sing. When I got back from South Africa, my only thought was maybe to have one artist from every genre to show solidarity. You know, maybe have whatever that would be, six or seven artists. And it just kept growing and growing. We, it was a crazy bunch of us that were just very dedicated to this thing. Me and Arthur Baker and Danny Schechter and Hart Perry. Hart Perry, the guy who videoed everything, you know, we call him up 2 o'clock in the morning and say, you know, Miles Davis just walked in, you know, get over here, you know? so not only that, but everybody who came in, we pretty much had the singers sing the entire song. And then I had to sort it out, you know, we sorted it out later as to which line went with which line, you know. Plus, well, we had so many talented people come in. You know, we wanted to make a statement about what was called rap at the time, soon to be called hip hop. The industry was very much prejudiced against rap music back then. And we wanted to really make a point by putting the first rappers on the record to make a statement about how important it was what they were doing. You know, for the first time in our history of the music business, you know, black artists were being able to actually express themselves, which was not the case. You know, white artists were expected to express themselves. It was part of the of being a rock artist. But for some reason, the black artists were simply not. And Marvin Gaye, of course, famously had to fight with Berry Gordy at Motown to be able to release What's Going On. And that loosened things up a bit. And, but we had the important people who were expressing themselves, like Gil Scott-Heron was probably one of the very first black artists to express himself. He was like one of the fathers, really, of rap in a way. But he was also in a jazz world, so things were a little bit looser, for him. Guys came in one at a time. The rappers came in, and we only had the rap in the middle and in the beginning. So we decided, why don't you guys just, write something and express yourself about South Africa, whatever you feel, We had like a log drum that we had laid down as our basic sort of, substituting for like a click track, basically. That was part of the song, but it was just a long log drum, whatever it was, 7-8 minutes of a log drum. And we had them rap over that, we had Miles Davis play over that log drum for 5 minutes. And, we only could use them 10 seconds in the intro and 10 seconds in the middle. Now, I'm not going to leave 4.5 minutes of Miles Davis on the floor. So we brought in Herbie Hancock and Tony Williams and Ron Carter to play along with what Miles did. And that became its own song. The rappers rapped, Melly Mel went to the corner, came back 15 minutes later with this fantastic rap. We turned that into a song. Arthur Baker started doing these montages of news footage and, the revolutionary song of South Africa, and mixing those things together, and that became its own song. Peter Gabriel came in and started doing this chant, and he started doing harmony with himself, and he created this fabulous chant. And our engineers took it upon themselves overnight to add drums to it. And I came in the next day, I was like, wow, well, and I put a guitar on that, and that became another song, So it grew very organically from one song to this amazing album that's quite legitimate as far as an album goes. It's not, just an afterthought. It's actually very, very creative stuff going on that album. And we just re-released it recently. And we are going to re-release the entire video next year, I think, with a lot of additions, because we have, Hart Perry got interviews with everybody, a lot of them are gone, who were on that record. So anyway, that was a purely passion, a passion project. Tell you the truth, I don't know how we pulled it off, okay? We pulled it off miraculously. I'm glad we did it then, because we couldn't do it now. And collaborating with other musicians is always tricky, because everybody's busy. And now everybody's even busier in a way, because everybody's struggling to survive, So it's hard to get any kind of charity stuff done now. We're in a permanent recession, and after this pandemic, yeah, we're going to be really in a permanent recession. We were already in trouble before this happened. We go all around the world, and the whole world is in trouble. All kinds of bad things going on. Nationalism everywhere, religious extremism everywhere, And I know why. People are just disappointed. They're disappointed with their lives. They're disappointed that they're working harder every single year, and they can't get ahead, But when people are struggling like that, it's hard to be charitable. It's hard to organize something for somebody else when you yourself, are struggling. So, and right now the struggle of the world is going to now be times 10. And it was already bad. Like I said, when you see nationalism popping up everywhere, closing borders and breaking ties and breaking treaties, going backwards for the first time in my lifetime, before the pandemic, we were going backwards. And, you know, we need to really focus. I'm hoping this next generation straighten some things out here, you know, as far as that goes. But I'm glad we did it when we did. And you know, it was really a complete victory.
Yeah, it's an incredible song. And as you also eloquently wrote in Solidarity, you know, we need solidarity as a species, right? That's what it's going to really come down to. That's what it's going to come down to.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I think with that, I think we're about out of time. I have a little thank you segment that should get played after this. Is there anything else that you'd like to say, though, before we wrap it up?
No, thank you for inviting me. I appreciate it, and I hope it's helpful. And you know, you're doing great work, obviously, you know, so just keep up the good work. You know, I love seeing, you know, young people, you know, playing instruments and writing songs. I mean, it's very encouraging, you know, and I think it's its own reward. You know, I think the students will be thanking you, you know, for helping them, you know.
Yeah, music is so important. Music is so important. And so is the technology. And I'd like to also, you know, before we get off, thank you to Joshua and Eddie behind the scenes. And there's some other thank yous that are going to play in this clip. On the behalf of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, Stuyvesant High School, and myself, thank you for everything that you're doing. And once again, teachers, check out TeachRock.org, TeachRock.org. They're doing incredible work. Everything's free. Everything's been pre-cleared for you guys, and you know, it's definitely something that you should take advantage of, which your students, I promise, will enjoy.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Take care, Stevie. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Maybe. I would also like to personally thank Linda Moran, President and CEO of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, April Anderson, Marketing and Communications Director of the Songwriters Hall of Fame, Francesca McCullough, AP of World Languages, Art, and Music here at Stuyvesant High School, as well as Eric Contreras, our principal, for their support and encouragement in putting today's event together. Last but not least, a big shout out to the incredible Teach Rock and Rock and Roll Forever Foundation team, including Christine Nick and Bill Carbone. Keep up the amazing work. Stay healthy, everyone, and be well. Until next time.